Hey guys, it's Shade here, the artist behind Sadie Saves the Day, and today I have a very special video to bring you. I am now officially a member of the Animal Artist Collective, and I'm so excited because I really believe in the cause of educating people about these different animals and just fostering a love for animals and our environment around us in general. So because I obviously have to make my life difficult, I chose three different animals. I chose fire coral, the humphead rasa or race, and the yellow-nosed albatross. I wanted to show you a little bit of my process for making this painting. I kind of was trying to plan out the values. I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. So I did a couple of different thumbnails, trying to figure out where I wanted my lights and my darks to be. This can be really helpful when you're trying to make a scene on your own and you don't have a lot of references that you can go by. If you've ever seen my work, you know that this isn't exactly the sort of thing that I do. I normally just paint a single subject on a white background. But this time I was kind of inspired to make a whole world. I'm from the Caribbean and I grew up next to the water. Actually, I used to live right on the water. And when my family moved, I think 30 minutes inland, I was so sad as a little girl that I actually recorded the sounds of the water before we moved so I could always have it with me. So that is how I feel about oceans and seas and rivers. Which is funny because I haven't lived near water since I went away to college. My first idea when I thought of this theme was jellyfish because I've been thinking about doing a jellyfish on black paper in gouache after doing those frogs the last time, but I ended up deciding not to do that. Then I wanted to do a manatee, but that was already taken. Then I wanted to do a vaquita, but that was already taken. So the next thing that I thought about was coral. I really love coral. I've always loved the color coral and the animals. In case you didn't know, coral is not just a stone or a plant. Coral is actually an animal made of tons of tiny little polyps that live within a skeleton, which is kind of made out of a calcium-like material. And I've always thought that coral are beautiful. And coral is also something that's really important to me. Being from the Caribbean, there is a huge coral reef in the Caribbean, which is under threat. So this is the first thing that I thought about. So now I'm just doing a little tiny color study. Don't worry, it's not going to look like this. This is super duper messy. Actually, I think Copic markers is probably a great way to do this kind of thumbnail because then you don't have to wait for things to dry or anything like that. But I just kind of wanted to see generally what sort of colors I wanted to wear. And this is all of the stuff that I did and all of the mess and the crazy that was going on for the pre-planning. So let's get into the actual painting. I'm starting out with putting down masking fluid. I use Pibeo masking fluid. It is latex free. The way that I keep my brush from getting all messed up is that I dip it every so often in a bit of water mixed with liquid soap. The thing that I end up doing though is that I have a problem with making the masking fluid too thin, so I make sure to add a lot more masking fluid. So I've covered up the albatrosses and now I'm just putting a first layer of paint on the whole thing. I wanted to do a little different shape. I kind of have like this oval that I'm going to turn into like a world. And on the bottom I have these fire coral kind of sticking out. I'm lifting out the clouds with a bit of tissue and I'm adding extra pigment at the edges because I kind of wanted it to look like it's a sphere. Now I went in and I added masking fluid for the fishes. I wanted them to have a little bit of blue on them, so that they looked like they were underwater, but I didn't want it to be too much so that everything was just blue. It takes a while to get all this coral with masking fluid on it. So why didn't I just do coral? That is a good question. Besides obviously wanting to make my life difficult, I, for some reason, didn't just want to paint coral. So I started thinking about doing the different levels of the ocean. There are several different levels of the ocean, and different fish and animals live at each different level. So I was thinking I would have the coral, and I would have some animals that live above it. But I didn't realize that coral actually lives in a quite shallow part of the ocean. In my mind, coral, for some reason, was all the way at the bottom, which doesn't make sense because I've seen coral, I've swum amongst coral before. I don't know why I thought coral was at the bottom of the ocean. So I kind of had to change my plan because I wanted it to be at least kind of realistic. And then I learned about the humphead rasa, which is a fish that actually lives amongst the coral. So that is really perfect for what I wanted to go. And then I thought, okay, let's add one more animal, something that's not just going to be in the water, something that's going to be above, and that's how I ended up with the albatross. So here I just darkened up the bottom of the water, and I'm dragging with my squirrel mop to make a kind of like light effect of light coming through the water. So that's how I ended up choosing all of those animals. Now it's time to take off the masking fluid. I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. I tried a little bit with my finger, I didn't like that. I tried with a clay tool, I didn't like that. I've seen people able to just kind of like pull up the masking fluid. Maybe that's the kind that has latex in it, it's extra gummy. But this kind of masking fluid, at least for me, it doesn't want to just come up as a whole thing. I have to really rub it. So that's why I'm using a glove and rubbing it with my finger, because I feel like I can get a little bit more grip, and then I'm also not getting my finger oils on the paper. Although the gloves broke several times and I had to get new ones. So this was a fun process and made a ton of mess. Okay, we're all cleaned up and I'm starting in with the coral. Now, the coral in the background is not any particular type of coral. It's any kind of coral. But I wanted to just go in and put that in first because I wanted to make sure I got some of the most complicated parts done before I added other things and I wouldn't be able to see where I was going. But while we're talking about the coral, let's talk about fire coral. First of all, fire coral is not really coral. I know last time I gave you a frog that wasn't really a frog, it was a toad, and now I'm giving you coral that's not really coral. It's called fire coral because it looks like coral, and they call it a fire coral because it stings. You do not want to touch this coral. Actually, that's the whole thing about them not being real coral. They are more closely related to hydras, so they are a hydrocoral. Now, what's a hydra? Well, one example of something like that is the Portuguese man of war. So you can kind of imagine what sort of animal this is. It's like a stinging sort of jellyfish. So the fire coral, which you can see at the bottom here, comes in bunches of different colors depending, and they can have different shapes depending on where they're living and what the flow of the water is there. There are about 50 different species of fire coral. The fire coral itself is not endangered, but some types of fire coral are amongst the rarest and most endangered types of coral in the world. And actually, there's even a type that has not been seen since 2008. Even though fire coral is not a true coral, the conservation methods for regular coral work for fire coral. And when regular coral is having difficulty surviving, fire coral also has difficulty surviving. Actually, already 20% of the world's coral has disappeared and it does not seem to be recovering. And it's also thought that 24% more are severely at risk of damage. So that means 44% of the world's coral is either gone or threat. That's a large amount of coral. What is causing all of this problem? Although some people say that the fire coral is great because it causes people not to go near coral reefs because they are afraid of getting stung. By the way, the sting of a fire coral can last anywhere between 2 days and 2 weeks. So one of the things that you should do if you've ever been stung by a fire coral, which I have not, thankfully, but if you ever do get stung by a fire coral, try to put some vinegar or some baking soda on it, or try to put hot water, don't put fresh water. And if it continues to give you an allergic reaction, go to the doctor, because some people are allergic to fire coral the same way that some people are allergic to bees. Now, I'm going in and I'm starting to paint in just like the most basic layers of the fish. These are the humhead rasa, which are actually really pretty fishies. And they're also really huge fishies. They can grow up to 2 meters long, which means they are bigger than me and up to 180 kilos. I think that's over 3 times my weight. So that's a pretty big fish. Not only that, but they're also gentle fish. Actually, they love being around divers. So they're pretty, they're huge, and they're gentle. So you can kind of see the appeal. Part of the reason why I chose the humphead rasa is because it's considered an umbrella species. An umbrella species is a species that if it is taken care of, a bunch of other animals that live in its habitat will be taken care of. And the humphead rasa actually lives in a huge habitat. Basically, its habitat is the entire coral triangle, which is an area that spans between Indonesia, Malaysia, Papua New Guinea, the Solomon Islands, Timor-Leste, and it has over 500 types of coral there. It is actually considered the global center of marine diversity. This is basically the Amazon of the seas, and it's just a really huge space. So not only would the protection of the humphead rasa protect itself, which is good in and of itself, but of course it would protect the coral reefs that it lives in, and it would also protect all of the other animals that are living in its habitat. So what is up with the humphead rasa? Why would anybody want to mess with this colorful fish? Actually, I just wanted to point out, you might have noticed that there are different colors in the fishes. The female fish is the one in the lower right, and the female fish tend to be more red purpley or red orangey, and they tend to be smaller than the male fish. They normally don't get above 1 meter. Then the two ones on the left are male fish. I'm not really sure about the one in the center. Maybe that's a female fish turning into a male fish, or a male fish turning into a female fish. These fish are actually hermaphrodites, and they can change sex over their lifespan. And the little tiny one in the back is a juvenile, basically a teenager or baby fish, and they tend to be kind of lime green or light green colored. So why would anybody want to mess with these big, gentle animals? Well, apparently, they used to be eaten by royalty, but now your regular person can get them. Well, maybe not your regular person, but your person with some money. They are a very expensive fish. They can go from anywhere between $100 to $300 per kilo, and apparently people will even pay $400 just for their lips. Humphead rasa are known for their big, thick lips, and some people will buy them for $400. This is particularly the case in China, where there has been already a tradition of it being associated with royalty and people of higher status, and the standard of living and the average income is rapidly rising. That's not the only problem that's facing these fish. Apparently, actually, their numbers have gone down 50% in the last 30 years for a bunch of different reasons, including cyanide and bombs being used for fishing. Apparently, cyanide is the best way to capture this fish alive, but because the rasa is immune to the majority of toxins, fishers who want to catch them to be later sold to eat or for the aquarium will throw cyanide into the area and grab the fish after they've been knocked out. They won't be killed, they'll just be knocked out. So the fish live, but what happens to everything else around it? The coral reef that they lived in, the other animals, the other fish, everything, all of that obviously gets killed. So that's extremely destructive. Besides being taken for food, which has led to, in Saba, this area having 99% of their population reduced, they are also taken for the aquarium trade because they are pretty fishies and they're gentle fishies. And people want the little baby fishies to look at. But when you take these fishies out of the ocean, there are no more fishies to make more fishies. Actually, these fish, they take a long time to mature. They can live up to 50 or 60 years, and they take about 6 years to sexually mature. So if you take too many of them out of the water at once, they just can't build back their numbers like something that can reproduce very quickly. So now I'm working on the top a little bit. It's like a sunset scene. I kind of wanted these wild colors. And it has an island in the background and several different of these albatrosses flying in the air. They were a lot of fun to paint and put in. These albatrosses are really funny. They stood out to me because basically they look like if you took like a regular albatross and maybe they went on Instagram too much and did a little bit too much contouring. They look really cool and like really severe. You should check them out. Look up the yellow-nosed albatross. They are actually pretty small birds. They're only 32 inches long. And they eat squid, fish, crustaceans, you know, sea stuff. The main danger to these birds is longline fishing. What's longline fishing? That's basically what it sounds like. It's when they take a long line and they attach hooks to it at several different parts. This is done to fish for different kinds of fish, but particularly tuna and swordfish. Okay, what does that have to do with birds? Well, these albatrosses love to follow fish boats, and they'll basically try to get food wherever they can. So when they see the bait on these long lines before it goes deep down into the water, they try and get it. And what happens is they get hooked instead of the fish. The yellow-nosed albatross also used to have a bit of an issue with poaching, but that was banned. And luckily the ban is actually being enforced, so that's not really a threat for them anymore. Another thing that I thought is really cool about them is that they can glide for hours without flapping. That's just how they like to fly. And if they really wanted to, they can fly around 100 kilometers per hour. But normally, it's around 40 kilometers an hour. But basically, so what can you do if you want to help out all of these animals? Like I said, the humphead ratha is an umbrella animal, and by helping it out, you can help out a lot of different animals. And that's a big thing that you can do, is try to make sure that you eat sustainable fish if you eat fish at all. Make sure that it's not legally fished, make sure that it's fished in a good way, and obviously try not to eat this fish. There are other fishes that you can eat that are not endangered. Try not to eat this one. I know it's pretty. Apparently it's very tasty. Don't do it. And besides that, climate change. Climate change and global warming is what's affecting all of the coral reefs around the world. That is why they're bleaching. That is why they're dying. And if the coral reefs die, then the humphead ratha will die and all of the animals that live in the coral reefs will die. So try to cut down on the things that you do or that you consume that produce greenhouse gases. It's the same things that people talk about all the time. Driving less, using bikes, using less energy, so that less fossil fuels are needed. All of these different kinds of things. Now, I know that my scene probably wouldn't really exist in their real life, especially since the yellow-nosed albatross's range is from South America to Africa. And I told you that the humphead ross's range is over by the Coral Triangle, which is in a slightly different area. I hope that you enjoyed hearing about all these different animals and that you can do what you can to help and protect them. I'm really honored to be with all of these other ladies, including Valerie, who is also brand new. Go check out her channel. I have a link to everybody's channels and everybody's videos. I'm really excited also to see what they did because I don't know yet. And this picture will be available for sale, and half of the proceeds will be going to the International Union for Conservation of Nature. They have a special unit that is dedicated to the preservation of the humphead rasa, so I thought that was really cool. So back underwater, I'm just trying to darken this up a bit and kind of make it match with the top a bit more, adding shadows behind the fish where I think the light wouldn't be reaching. And I also added the shadows in between all the little coral. This is the massive, massive mess that I made. It's kind of a war zone. So I hope this was fun and entertaining and that you like the painting. I had a lot of fun. It was definitely something that I don't normally do. And that's the really cool thing about this collective. It's really making me learn a lot of stuff and it's really pushing me out of my comfort zone. Thank you to my patrons who are always there. I love asking you questions and sharing little things about my life with you. Please become a patron if you wanna hang out and chat some more. Please like, comment, subscribe, all the good stuff. I'll talk to you guys next time. Bye.